Good morning, Saints. I put that on because I don't really preach a song, but I want you to turn with me to begin this. Oh, I'm very serious because that song has something very important to say, but that's not our text. But I want you to turn to the book of 2 Kings. And I'm not trying to make light of study, you know, because Paul said before he was going to pass away, you know, in 2 Timothy, before his departure was coming, he said, bring me the books and the parchments. So study is important. Before I go any further, Father God, we ask your blessings upon your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. But I want you to turn to 2 Kings for a moment. And the book of 2 Kings, I want to say turn to chapter 3. So Elisha is the prophet. And I'm going to just give you a quick summation. This has nothing to do with our sermon. This has to do with Pastor John. And then we'll get to the sermon proper. But some people study, pray. But you know what Elisha said? This is what Elisha said before he prophesied. What happens is the Israelites are going to war. They've invited Judah to go along with them and another king from Edom. And what happens is they're going against this army. And so Elisha comes. And this is what it says. Verse 13. We'll start at 13. Then Elisha said to the king of Israel, what have I to do with you? Go to the prophets of your father and the prophets of your mother. But the king of Israel said to him, no, for the Lord has called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. And Elisha said, as the Lord of hosts live, before whom I stand, surely were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not look at you nor see you. But now bring me a musician. Do you see what it says? Bring me a musician. Then it happened when the musician played that the hand of the Lord came upon him. So I'm going to play that song one more time. Not the whole song, but I just want you to listen to the beginning of the song. CJ.
Hey, son.
Amen. So you see what it says? That you're a spiritual being having a what? Natural experience. Now, I'm not going to dwell on this, but just for a couple of moments, we realize that right now, today, on April 5th, 2020, there is a natural experience taking place. It is the natural experience of a virus that has run somewhat rampant through our country. But why do I bring that up? Because the song is letting you know that there's a spiritual way to look at these things and a natural way to look at these things. Now, whether you realize it or not, the answer for this is found right in what we read in the book of Luke. Turn to Luke chapter 19. Please stand for the reading of God's revered word. And we're going to read that passage in Luke chapter 19. And I'm going to focus on the particular text in question today. So in Luke chapter 9, verse 37, this is what it says. Then as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen. Amen. Please be seated. Once again, Father God, we're going to ask your hand of mercy and grace upon this time in your word, that you would bless this word for your glory and our much needed good. We thank you for who you are in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. So look at this passage right here now. Look at what it says happened. It says the disciples began to do what? Began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen. I want you to look at that passage closely, because what happens at times in our life, we may have to remind ourselves of the mighty works of God. See, if you're a natural person, all you can focus on is the natural circumstances. If you're a natural person, you don't know about the mighty works of God. If you're a natural person, the only way you can find joy, comfort, and serenity are through the natural means, circumstances, events, and situations of life. But wait a minute. If you're a spiritual person, you can find hope, joy, cheerfulness, enthusiasm in the mighty works of God. Now, if you don't believe in God, I have a word for you later. But this is for the saints of God who believe in God, to remind ourselves that we are spiritual beings and we need to look through this spiritually. So I want to turn you to one passage. Again, besides Luke, keep your eyes on Luke. But I want to turn you to the Gospel of John. So as we look at the Gospel of John, chapter 21. Because I want to make sure that anybody who hears this understand what's being preached today. Sickness comes to the saint as well as to the sinner. The person who loves Jesus and the person who does not love Jesus may have long, healthy lives or may die in car accidents. Solomon is right. One event happens to them all. But I want to notice, want you to notice something very closely in John 21 that may shed a little light on what's going on today. See, the Bible has a way, a spiritual way of looking at things. Some of you may be saying, what's in John 21? Well, look here. Now, turn to verse 18, John 21. Because before we talk about the mighty works of God, I have to make sure I set the right mental framework for the saints of God. Amen. Because there are times where saints get caught up in the natural. And they may say, oh, praise the Lord. But in their hearts, they're worried. They may say, oh, God is good in all the time. But secretly, they have doubts. So now we want to look at what this word says in John 21, verse 18. Most assuredly, I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself and walked where you wished. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish. This he spoke, verse 19, this he spoke, signifying by what death he would, and what's those next two words? Did you know you could glorify God in death? Come on now. Did you know you could glorify God in death? Why I say that when we get ready to talk about God's mighty works, because some people may think a mighty work is healing. Healing is not the only mighty work that God does. See, if you watch CNN and even saints now, saints keep saying praying for healing. But we need to understand that God is mighty whether my mother is sick or not. God is powerful whether I'm sick or not. Whether I get well or not, God is still mighty and awesome. So you notice how Jesus informed his head disciple, Peter, about his upcoming death. History records Peter was crucified upside down. He did not believe himself worthy to be crucified like Jesus. But notice how it's defined, how it's described. The death by which he would what? Glorify God. See, when you understand who God is, you understand God can get glory in our death. Oh, that's very important to keep that in mind. Because now when we talk about his mighty works, we want to remind ourselves, that death for us, amen, it's just another opportunity to glorify God. Turn back to the Gospel of Luke. So now in the Gospel of Luke, we come back to this passage. Then as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen. Now, these disciples and this whole multitude, I'm sure that this multitude had some problems themselves. In that multitude, there might have still been some sick, some unemployed, sick parents. But we want to learn as spiritual individuals to allow our praise to ring out no matter our personal circumstances because of God's mighty works. When we start to think about how great this God is, we have to meditate on it. We start to think. So you go back, you see, because one of the problems about praising God that we may have, that we think of praise for God primarily in the first person. What has God done for me? Now, he may have done a lot for us. But if you notice in the book of Psalms, throughout the scripture, when they talk about God's works, you know one of the works they always talk about? Say it again, brother. Coming out of Egypt. Isn't that amazing that 400, 500, 600, 800 years later, they're talking about God bringing the people out of Egypt? Because they understand that whatever happens in their life, God brought his people out of Egypt. That is a mighty work that will never be altered. But if I am limited to praising God because of my paycheck, my praise will be short-lived. If I'm limited to praising God because of my personal health, my praise will be greatly diminished. But if I'm able to praise God because in his great mercy, he sent Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees, formed this nation Israel, revealed himself to Moses by a name that nobody else knew, I am who I am, and then brought them out of Egypt, I could praise God all day. See, we have to learn how to praise God because of his mighty works, not because of his personal work toward me. Now, he may have done some mighty works in my life, but you'll notice that the men and women inspired by Scripture, by the Holy Spirit that are recorded in Scripture, their praise is based on the greatness of God. If you look at Mary's prayer, when she praises God for Jesus, it's almost word for word what Hannah prayed. See, many times we're so busy taught in our new age to what has God done for you? He's going to bless you. God blesses other people. Learn to rejoice in what God did for other people. Learn to rejoice that even though the Israelites were rebellious, he was raining bread from heaven. As wicked as stubborn as they were, he did not let them starve. As a matter of fact, you know what he did? He put Payless out of business. He gave them shoes that would not wear out. Amen? Amen? Oh, no. See, what happens is, that's why I like the beginning of the song. When you're a natural person, all you could do is look at material objects, material circumstances, and decide what your mood is going to be for the day. And granted, there are some who are able to rise above it. But think about some of the mighty works. So we know about Egypt. Think about, I know one of them I love is Elisha. So now you have this picture. I always bring up Elisha because he's a spiritual being. See, Elisha sees the servant sees this army surrounding them. This whole Syrian army is going to take in Elisha and his servant Gehazi. So the servant is nervous. You know, people get nervous when they what? Look at the natural circumstances. That's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, we walk by faith and not by sight. See, I can take by faith the mighty works that are done. Some of them saw firsthand mighty works, and hopefully we have seen some mighty works in our life. But you know, let me tell you the difference between a real testimony and what I call the church version. The church version is when I got to say, oh, God is good. He did this for me. But when you have a real testimony, you could call it back 40 years ago because you know what God did 40 years ago. It was real, and you knew the power of God in such a way that it lingers with you, that you do not doubt God, and you are able to embrace whatever God brings to you. Oh, there's a difference between, as I say, the church version and the real testimony. Because many of us will say, I know God is good. But again, when any circumstance comes that's not fit into our personal liking, we're thrown off. As opposed to what did the psalmist say? You see it in Psalm 119. I was glad when he afflicted me, for then I learned your statutes. So we go back to Elisha. There's a mighty, what happens? So this Syrian army is around them. And Gehazi is nervous. You can read about this in 2 Kings. He's nervous. So does Elisha say, and it's interesting what Elisha prays. Elisha doesn't pray for the army to disappear. Turn with me to 2 Kings for a moment. See, because you know what? Amen. Amen. See, one of the mighty works that we have to understand is that God wants us to see him through the circumstance. We keep wanting God to change a circumstance. Elisha doesn't pray for God to change a circumstance. So I want you to read this. I was going to do it from heart, but I don't want to mangle a passage. So turn to 2 Kings chapter 6. And see, if we can get some of these mighty works into our blood, we will not be like the world. This is why I say it's so important for us to gather. I say this because where two or three are gathered, what happens? There I am in the midst of them. How do I know that's true? Well, first of all, I got a witness. Brother Mosley says he comes here because he doesn't want to miss something. He doesn't want to miss something. I come because I know that the way I'm feeling now was not the way I felt when I got into the car this morning. But I know. See, I've learned by now that when I get here, something's going to happen. Because folks are going to bring something in with them. Hopefully the good thing. Hopefully the good thing. But we know, amen. So now when two or three are gathered, things change. And I don't know why I picked that song, but I didn't pick it for that reason this morning. I just said, you know what? That's more of an upbeat song. I think people are feeling a little down. But then as I was listening, I said, that's the song of the day. And then I thought of Elisha. He said, bring me a musician. And then the hand of the Lord came upon him. Now, you'll know at the end of the sermon if the hand of the Lord was upon me. I would never take that liberty to say that. But I know that when I heard those words, I said, oh, man, amen. Because as I said before, this is becoming my new. You know, you get some lines and you run them into the ground. But like I said, CNN, they give you breaking news. What does breaking news do? It breaks your heart. The Bible gives you good news. It restores your heart. So you keep watching CNN. Hello out there in listener land. You keep watching CNN, NBC, and ABC, and you will be depressed. You put 5 hours into breaking news of your heart. You put 5 hours into the Bible, and you'll see the difference. So you look at 2 Kings chapter 6. You call folks. You could tell they've been watching the news. You could tell. They didn't even have to tell you they watch the news because they don't have nothing to say about Jesus. They don't have nothing to say about the glory of God in the middle of this. Did you know that no disease takes away God's glory? Did you know that sometimes disease could bring glory to God? How do we know that? He testified of the death by which he would glorify God. So you know if God can get glory in death, you know he could get glory in illness. See, but you got to understand how mighty this God is. Now, again, this is for the saint. If folks don't believe in God, I have another word for them on another day. But this, no, amen. Because if you don't believe in God, what are you going to put your hope in? Medicine? You're going to put your hope that the governor, the president, the CDC? Hopefully by now we know that in any moment God could spin this. God could spin this in such a way and say, I'm going to break you down. I was reading Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel the other day, how he broke him down, had him in the beasts, like beasts in the wilderness. Seven, break him down. So you look now. We haven't even had a million deaths yet, but things are shut down. Now, we pray the Lord would do well. We pray there would be some humility, but we want to understand that God's mighty works. Folks are worried. Oh, where is God? I know where he is. He's at the throne. Jesus is at the right hand. The Holy Spirit is living in his believers. Amen. I can rejoice in those mighty works. Jesus is at the right hand interceding for his people. But if you keep watching the statistics, you're going down mentally. You got to look at some mighty works. So I want to show you how our brother Elisha prayed. See, Elisha was a man, first-hand mighty works. First-hand mighty works. He did mighty works. So he was not worried about much. So you look at 2 Kings chapter 6. So I want you to follow this here. The Syrians have sent this army to surround him. He's in a place called Dothan. And we're going to pick this up, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 13. Now, here's a mighty work. This is a mighty work done centuries ago. But me, I have hope in this mighty work. When David talked about, do not forget your covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. David didn't talk about what God had did for him personally. He was able to talk about what God had did for other generations. One of the reasons we are so limited is because in the scriptures, we are not able to really rejoice in what God did for his saints. Oh, yeah, when you can rejoice that God brought Daniel out of a lion's den, you're going to have praise for the rest of your life. Because anything that comes up, you know, I know Daniel, a lion's den, amen. When you know that God parted the Red Sea, when you know he brought the 3 Hebrew boys out, when you know he put Jonah in the fish because he was rebellious, even though he hated the people, he took them out to do the job, you say, you know what? God is in control. God could put him in a fish, take him out of a fish, and let him go preach the gospel. God is in control. So you can praise him with a loud voice for his mighty works. See, but what happens is, again, we are supposed to be spiritual beings, understanding things spiritually. But many of us, we're supposed to be spiritual, but we're caught up in the natural. And the news stays on. Then we're on the internet. Oh, who, what? And then, oh, who got this? Make sure, I went to Costco the other day, not making light, but it was interesting. I went to Costco, 8 out of 10 people had a mask. And then I told my wife, BJ's has a different clientele. 2 out of 10 had a mask. Folks were standing up there talking to each other face to face. Like, yeah, what up? Wait, what's going on? I ain't paying this. You know, like they were just buddies talking. But I said, what a difference. It shows you how our mind looks at things. And I did say this, please understand. There are some people who will be upset if you don't get it. You understand? Because we, you know, having church, some people are saying, oh, they still have church. And, you know, some people are wishing evil on some churches. They're wishing evil. You know that. See, they don't care. No, we care about people, but we want to praise God. And we want to encourage each other in the Lord. Enough said on that. So look at 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 13. So he said, go and see where he is, that I may send and get him. And it was told him, saying, surely he is in Dothan. Therefore he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man of God rose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? Did you see that? This is what happens when you don't know the power of God. Because if you know the power of God, what is the first thing you know you could do? Pray. Come on now. And now this is where you find out how much you know God. Because some people say they're going to pray, but you know they're nervous. But if you know God has power, you're going to pray. And you know the end result will be for the glory of God. Amen. See, the prayer is not to change circumstances to my liking. You know, we read this prayer book before we go to bed at night. My wife has picked up this book, so there's little excerpts about prayer. But it's some great lines in there. So there's some quotes about prayer. One of the quotes is, prayer is not to change circumstances to my liking. Prayer is to change me to be to God's liking. Oh, come on, you didn't hear that. You didn't hear that. Prayer is not to change circumstances for my liking. Now, God does change circumstances to our liking because he's just like a good God. Amen? He's just a good God. He does things for his children because we're like children. We want cookies when we need spinach. Right? We want candy when we need broccoli. We want play when we need worship. Have mercy. But God, in his generosity, in his compassion, in his mercy, gives us things that we just like. We just like them. He gives them. But understand that prayer, if we consider prayer simply something to change events, to change circumstances, and not primarily to change us, we're missing the point of prayer. The idea of prayer is that in this communion with God, in this fellowship with the Savior, what happens is I become more aware of who he is. I become more aware of who I am. And Lord, change me. Lord, change me. Remember, prayer is not primarily for God to give us what we like. It is primarily so that we can be changed into the likeness of God. Hey, whole different tone. Whole different tone. Now, when you understand that, you could praise God in the middle of the flu, in the middle of a tsunami. You could praise God in the middle of persecution in Cambodia and China where they burned down a church. We pray for a church in Cambodia because they closed all the other churches. They left one church standing in Cambodia. Read it in Voice of the Martyrs a couple of years ago. Closed all the churches. Amen. We see the pastor got arrested here because there are people who don't believe in this gathering. But when you know the mighty work of God, you know this is where we need to be. Oh, amen. Look at what it goes on to say. Therefore, he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, alas, master, what shall we do? What shall we do is the natural response. Because when you say, what shall we do? You might say, Lord, what shall I do? Amen. But this is the response of panic. This is the response of confusion. But at least you got to give him credit because you know what he's doing? By the way, mark this down. He's asking a man of faith. Amen. When you want to know what to do, you better find somebody who knows God. You better find somebody who walks closely with the Savior, who sees everything through a spiritual lens, and ask them, what should we be doing? Because you could go to religious people. Let me say this again. You could go to religious people and you know what they're going to tell you? Religious people will tell you, you need to crucify Jesus. Caiaphas, Annas. Amen? High priests and elders. But you got to find somebody who knows God in a different way. And when they know him in a different way, when you ask, it may not be the answer that anybody else is giving you. But it's the answer from God. Amen. Oh, yes. What shall we do? So look at what he says. Verse 16. You could tell this is right out of the book of Jesus. Look at the first words he says. So he answered, do not fear. Isn't that amazing? How many times does Jesus tell his disciples, don't be afraid? Why did you doubt? Where is your faith? He's like, what are you worried about? Don't you know who runs the planet? Come on. Amen. Hello, does anybody know who runs the planet? Does anybody know who runs the planet? Because if you know who runs the planet, there's no need to fear. Because even in death, he's going to get glory. Now, let me just explain one of the conflicts for the natural person. The conflict is this. If I'm worried about preserving my life, I'm thrown off my game. If I'm worried about preserving my life, I'm thrown off my game. But if I'm worried about God getting glory, I'm good to go. Come on. Because if God gets glory, he might get in my death. I think that's so important. Because the main concern right now is what? Well, amen, in the church, but in the world, it's health. But for the saints, I fear we get caught up in this. We forget that the most important thing at all times is God's glory. Oh, yes. Most important thing is God's glory. God's glory. Look at what it says here. Alas, master, what shall we do? So he answered, do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Right now, for that moment, before he prays, Gehazi's like, is this man losing his mind? What's in that man's coffee? Because guess what? Gehazi sees nothing but a Syrian army. Amen. Oh, come on now. See, when you can only see the natural, it's depressing. When you can only see the natural, you're going to be downcast. But when you could see behind the scenes, look at what he goes on to say. Verse 17, and Elisha what? Elisha what? He prayed. So notice the difference. One person, what shall we do? Elisha prayed. But you know who he's praying for? Because he knows. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray. Open his eyes. Come on now. Come on. See, when our eyes are open, we can see the mighty work of God. I can see the mighty work of God in what's going on right now. And I can say this without... Sometimes when you read the Bible, you have to realize people just need to be brought low. America is raised up. For whatever reason, we think we're invincible. If you're going to talk about anybody, not just I'm talking, anybody that thinks America is great, you need to say Jesus right behind it. You need to say any greatness come, you need to give God some praise. But we have become a nation where we don't want anybody talking about God publicly. You keep that private to yourself. Right. So God's like, let me show you how I, let me make something public. Let me make public your inability to handle something. And you know, God in his mercy, he may just pass this by. Amen. But look at what he says. Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may what? See. Come on now. I want you to notice. He says, open their eyes that he may see. He does not pray. Mark this down. If you don't remember anything else, mark this down. He did not pray, take away the army. We're so busy asking God to take away something sometimes, we don't ask God to open people's eyes that they may see. People, even the church, so concerned about praying for something to be taken away. Now, understand this. This is Elisha, and the army is surrounding who? Elisha and his servant. This is not a man who's unaffected by the trial. Elisha is surrounded by an army, by an enemy military, but Elisha does not pray, take the military away. Elisha first prays for the Lord to open his servant's eyes. Because the more to Elisha, he wants the servant to see what he sees. And of course, I pray that as a pastor, I pray that if somebody's listening to this, they would see Jesus the way I see Jesus. Better yet, let me rephrase that. I hope they see Jesus more clearly than I see Jesus. Hopefully, if they hear this, they will see Jesus in a way that they can say, oh, Pastor John, you missed this. And Pastor John, you missed that. Amen. But you want people to see that God is going to get his glory no matter what. Then he says, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. Then the Lord opened his eyes, opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots, a fire all around Elisha. Now, did you just read that? Did you just read that?
Amen.
No, you didn't read that. Amen. So let me ask you a question now. Let me ask you a question. You read that? Did you read that?
Yes.
Okay. So now I'm going to tell you what you should be thinking. I'm going to tell you again what you should be thinking. I'm going to tell you what you should be thinking. If you have an army of chariots of fire surrounding Elisha, what do you think is surrounding any human being who's bought by the blood of the Lamb? If you are a believer in Jesus, washed in the blood, Jesus is praying for you. Do you know what's around you? Do you know what Hebrews says? Turn to the book of Hebrews. Turn to the book of Hebrews for a moment. Mighty work of God. This is another mighty work.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Am I going to get you shouting, brother?
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 2, verse 16. Remember what the book of Hebrews says? I won't turn to this one. We have a better covenant. If God sent an army of chariots, come on, for Elisha, anybody purchased by the blood of Jesus, and Elisha is a saint, amen. But why would we think? See, this is what you got to understand, the mighty works. I may see something in America, but I just got to see behind America and see that God's glory is all over the place. One of the problems, we can't see God's glory. We're too busy on the internet. We're too busy on the internet. And you know what happens? We don't consider the moons and the stars. You know what David said? A mighty work. He rejoiced in what? When I consider the moon and the stars, when you consider it, it reminds you how great God is. But if you're still considering the news, you can't meditate on the creation. And what does the Romans say? Creation speaks of his glory. His eternal attributes are visible. When you see the sun, by the way, just so you know, do you think coronavirus could live in the middle of the sun? Burn to a crisp. I know Jesus got this hands down.
Amen.
But Jesus allows, permits, or even decrees certain things for a time so saint and sinner could learn some lessons about his glory and learn to rejoice in his mighty works.
Amen.
Oh, come on.
Amen.
Oh, God is on the throne.
Amen.
Oh, he's on the throne. You could say with ease, the Lord got this. You know, Elisha, he wasn't from the Bronx like me. But Elisha was really saying to Gehazi, you know the Lord got this. There's more with us than with them. How could be there so many and you cannot see this? He's like, Lord, open this boy's eyes. He didn't say boy, but you know, Elisha was that kind of guy. Open his eyes. I don't need that, because you know what happens if the chariots go away? Don't miss it. If the chariots go away, watch this now, Gehazi doesn't see the glory of God. Come on. See, if you pray for the chariots to go away, you think, oh, the circumstance changed. He say, no, the circumstance doesn't need to change. You just need to see God's glory in a more magnificent way. This is why those disciples, for the mighty works they had seen. See, we don't see because we're not asking the Lord to open our eyes. Lord, open our eyes that we may see your glory in all circumstances in life. And the next thing you know, we'll be able to raise our voice loudly in praise because we have personally seen God's greatness. And notice, David didn't pick some unusual miracle. He says, when I consider the moon, the stars, the works of your hands. The problem is, we don't really think about. Just today we were talking about the lion. You think of the lion, the elephant, the giraffe, the rhino, the hippopotamus, the alligator, the crocodile. Then you think about Mercury, Jupiter, Mars, the stars, the sun, the galaxies. And now what? I'm supposed to get nervous? Oh, no, this is a chance to give God glory. Amen. What did he tell Peter? By the death, he would glorify God. You could give God glory as you're going to die. You could give God glory. Look at what it says here. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. Inasmuch then, as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death, he might destroy those who had the power of death. That is the devil. Oh, the power of what? He destroyed who? Him. Destroyed him who had the power of what? Death. Natural people can't enter that. If you don't believe in God, you have to worry about death. If you don't believe in God, the best you could do is if you don't believe in God, is just say, I'm just going to go to nothing. But if you believe in God, you got glory waiting. And I leave people to make the choice. I have a book. Yes, it's written by men. Men under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. It tells me that there's a place of no sorrow, no death, no crying, eternal joy. And guess what? I don't even need a flashlight. Lamb of God, glory of God, lights up the whole city. Streets paved with gold. And more to be said about heaven. That's another sermon. We might have to double it up today. But see, when saints are earthly minded, you're going to be depressed. When you're heavenly minded, as you know, they used to say that people are so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. But the intelligent saint says, if I'm not heavenly minded, I'm no earthly good. The earth has plenty of people who think about earth. The earth needs people who think about heaven so they can interpret life in light of Jesus. So they can interpret life in light of Jesus and give you some hope that goes beyond the next medical cure. Because just like HIV and tuberculosis and smallpox and measles and mumps and rubella and pancreatic cancer and leukemia, amen? And there's another one's coming down the pike. But Jesus doesn't move. Jesus doesn't move. Oh, you got to raise your voice and praise this great God. You got to raise your voice and give him some glory. Oh, it's all right. You know what? Because I'm going to be all right praising him. Because you know what Jesus said? Even if nobody else prays, rocks are going to join in. Yeah. That's why I could preach. Amen. I could preach when folks are not even paying attention. Because you know who pays attention? God of glory. God loves to hear his name exalted.
Amen.
So I know that's a good sermon. A good sermon is when I'm exalting Jesus. I hope I'm exalting him. I hope I'm exalting him. So look at what the rest of it says. First of all, he destroyed the power of death. That's a mighty work. Yes. Now, we haven't seen that because we haven't died yet. But let me tell you, I get the feeling that Lazarus could tell you about the power of death being destroyed. He's in Abraham's bosom, taken by angels. We know that today is Sunday. Oh, in 7 days, we're going to celebrate. Oh, and I think this is monumental. In 7 days, what will we be celebrating technically? Eight? The resurrection of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Isn't it ironic that in the midst of this, we would have that celebration the world called Easter. Some call it Resurrection Sunday. Whatever name, if you don't have eyes to see the truth that he is risen. And you know what? You know the line you got to love in there? Why are you searching for the living among the dead? People are looking for joy on planet Earth. People are looking for hope on planet Earth. You're looking for a living hope on a dead planet. You're looking for a living hope on a dead planet why are you searching for life among the dead? Come on now. Resurrection in the middle of this to remind saints, you don't think I'm bigger than this? I destroyed the one who has power over the grave and death. You like the way Paul says it in 1 Corinthians? What's the mighty word? Oh, grave, where is your victory? If he's asking it like, what?
Right.
What? Oh, grave, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Don't you know the sting of death is the law? This is washed up in Christ Jesus. Amen. You might, listen, if you got the book, you might as well buy into the whole package.
Amen.
Because if you're buying into the part about you're the head and not the tail, it's going to get dry really soon. If you buy into the part that you're going to be the lender, not the ball, well, when your money runs out, how are you going to praise him? But if you praise him because we created the moon, amen. If you're praising him because he created the stars, your praise won't run out. If you're praising him what he did for the Israelites, your praise will not languish. If you praise him because of what he did for David and Goliath, what he did for Elisha, what he's doing for us through the right hand at the Father with Jesus Christ, your praise won't get weary. Oh my gosh. You got to believe it. But you know, and I've learned this. I can't preach what I don't have. I mean, God bless actors who could act it. But listen, if I didn't know Jesus, I wouldn't even want to be here. I used to be playing football on Sundays. Glory to God. Glory to God. Look at the rest of the passage because we haven't got to it yet. Look at it. So, and look. That he might destroy him who had power of death. That is the devil. And release those who through fear of death. Fear of death. You know, there's people who fear death. Did you know that? There are people who fear death. You know what Jesus does? He releases them from that fear. Isn't that amazing? There are people in the world who actually fear dying, but they won't go to Jesus. They fear, let me say that again. They fear dying, but they will not go to Jesus. Jesus releases them from the power of the grave.
Amen.
And that's when you know if you believe Jesus. Because there are people who say, hey, it's all right. I'm going home. They say it matter of fact, I'm going home. Listen, you know what? It's a tough exit. My body's racked with this cancer. It's a tough exit, but I'm going home. The end is going to be better than this. Right? They don't fear death. They welcome it. And not because there's no more pain in that earthly sense, but there's no more pain and I see Jesus. Look at what the rest of the passage says. And release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. You know, people are really worried, and I mean this sincerely. People are worried about their kids getting it. You see people with the masks and the gloves. I'm not making any medical comments. I'm just saying that when you know Jesus, remember there are people who live in lands where there's no health care. There are people who live in lands where they don't have access to Lysol. You know that, right? There are people who live in lands where scarlet fever, malaria, and all types of disease is in there. It's in the womb. The child is born with disease. But they praise Jesus. They cry over the lost son and they give glory to God. And they trust he's in the arms of a savior. They don't fear death. There are countries where they live with death. In America, we don't talk about death. And I'm very serious about this. Please understand. We no longer want people to mourn. This is very serious. We tell everybody when somebody dies, it's a celebration of life. You know what they did when Moses died? Listen to me closely. Here's a lesson, a biblical lesson. When Moses died, it said they mourned 30 days. When Aaron died, they mourned 30 days. When Jacob died, they mourned. Ecclesiastes is better to go to the house of mourning. One of the problems that we have in our land, we are so afraid of death. See, the fear of death. We can't really embrace death because we fear it so much. So we reword it and call it a celebration of life. But I know that Moses, right? Joshua knows God, amen? But he mourns. It's all right to mourn when somebody passes. It's all right to mourn. It's all right to mourn when somebody passes. But we keep saying celebration of life because we have fallen into the trap of the natural because we can't celebrate heaven. I don't need to celebrate life. I could celebrate heaven where they're going. See, when you have to celebrate life, you can only talk about what a person did on the planet. But watch this. But when you celebrate redemption, when you celebrate the mighty work of the cross at a funeral, if it's a believer in Jesus, oh, come on now. Now you could party. Because that brother just went to the Bahamas. That sister just went home to Barbados or wherever they want to go. You understand? I mean, really. Anybody with me on this? You could celebrate this. But see, when we buy into the passing the way the world does, we start praying like the world. But we don't say, God, get glory in this. Get glory in this. So look at the rest of the passage. We still haven't finished with this one yet. And release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. Now, I know it was 20 minutes ago. Praise God. Going back to Elisha and the chariots. Look at what it says. For indeed, he does not give aid to the angels. Does not give aid to angels. But he does give aid to the seed of who?
Abraham.
Come on. Come on. Did you just see what that said? He gives aid to the seed of Abraham. If somebody is a believer in Jesus, they're the seed of Abraham. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, down the line, David, Solomon, eventually Jesus. And we are the spiritual descendants of Abraham. We are the spiritual. So you know what? When Peter's in jail, who comes to Peter? They're praying, but the angel shows up. Amen? Come on. Angels show up after Jesus is tempted by Satan. Amen. Watch this. If Elisha had chariots of fire, I can only imagine what we have. Because we have a better covenant. We have a better covenant. So when we come in here, you may see the banners, but who knows? One day, the Lord may open our eyes. And you may see at that door. You may see at that door. You may see sitting in these four seats. One day you may open your eyes. Lord may open our eyes and say, here's just a glimpse. Let me just show you. And you see they're going to take a seat because they're at home here, hopefully. But just in case things get out of hand, they're ready. Angels taking care of the believers. Come on now. Oh, you got to know mighty work. Amen. You got to know mighty work. Amen. You got to be able to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice. Oh, man. It's funny. I had a whole nother sermon lined up, you know, through the week. I said, oh, I know what this is. Because I saw a passage in Luke. Oh, yeah, it's the line where it says, the Lord has need of it. And I was going to preach on that. But then the Lord says, no, look at what's going on around you. Don't they know how mighty I am? Your job today is remind people how mighty I am. Your job today is to remind people that I'm the God who's on the throne. I kill, I make alive, I wound, and I heal. I make the seeing and the blind. I make the deaf and the hearing. I make all things. All things are by my power. And without him, nothing was created that was made. That's what it says in 1 John. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And all things were made by him and through him. And without him, nothing was made. I didn't quote it exactly right, but turn to 1 John chapter 1, verses 1, 2, and 3. And in him, and by the way, in him was life. In him was life. Everybody's worried about sickness. Go to Jesus. You get life. Oh, you get a different kind of life. You get a life that cannot be touched by any virus, death, or sickness. The soul is impregnable. Oh, amen. That's the kind of life. He says, I come that they might have life and life more abundantly. When you're natural, you keep thinking that means a bigger house, a bigger car, a bigger bookcase, a bigger limo, a bigger pool. That's what people think. Preachers preach that. But when you understand abundant life, it means your soul is filled with the glories of Jesus. Amen. The soul, amen, in him was life. When you get life from Jesus, your body, Paul says, our man is perishing. Read in 2 Corinthians. Our man is perishing. He's going down. But the inward man is being renewed day by day. Oh, amen. Amen. Glory to God. Let's go back to that passage again. Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19. Because I'm going to conclude like this. I want you to look at this passage here. I want you to see what it says here. Everybody got Luke 19? Look at the word. Look at the word. And some of the Pharisees called him religious people. And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." Huh? Let me explain something to you. I want to say this with reverence. I want to say this with kindness, with compassion, but I want to say this. When your birthday party has gone bad, we're in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. We were reading verses 39. I might have said 37, but 39. And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." When your birthday party is bad, you might want other people's birthday party to be bad. Huh? When your car breaks down and you don't like somebody, you wonder why their car's still working. See, the Pharisees couldn't rejoice with these other people. Let me tell you something. If people around you can't rejoice, you keep on praising God. You don't have to praise him obnoxiously, but you keep on praising him. Oh, amen. See, he's saying shut them up because they can't enter in to the glory, to the majesty, to the worship of this great Savior. And it's interesting because you know what? They saw mighty works. They saw Lazarus being raised from the dead. They knew people had been healed. But you know what? When unbelief is in the heart, you can't give God glory no matter what you see. When unbelief is in the heart, you don't want nobody else to give God glory. So right now, we need to be mindful that we want to be agents of mercy. We want to show compassion, but we want to praise God. I don't have to be quiet about Jesus to show mercy to somebody. I can show you mercy through Jesus and let you know the only reason I'm showing you mercy is because of Jesus. But I don't have to put Jesus on the side. Amen. See, people, you know, and it's interesting this week, Samaritan's Purse was out there. They were doing some work, a gospel organization. You don't hear nobody saying, "Oh, look at those people. They believe in Jesus doing the work." Now, they believe in Jesus. Samaritan's Purse is right out the Bible. But nobody wants to talk about Jesus. Although they're out there helping load bodies, helping with all kind of work. And many of them uncovered. Uncovered. Everybody to have on a mask. But guess what? They're showing mercy because God showed them mercy. See? See, we live in a world where they go out of their way not to give God glory, even when the glory-giving people are helping you out. Amen. What's wrong with saying, you know, these folks believe in Jesus. Look at how they help. Right? You have no problem putting a scandal on the TV. You throw that up there on Nightline and Dayline or whatever other line. But now people are helping. I don't hear nothing about that. But let a pastor do something, 25 cameras, every tabloid. But I know the world in which I live. So that's why in here we give God glory. Because ain't nobody out there going to give him glory. They're going to tell you, be quiet. Why don't you be quiet? Jesus rebuked your disciples. What? Look at what they want to. Blessed is the king who comes in. Why should I rebuke him for that? I'm the king. I'm coming in the name of the Lord. What should I quiet them for? Oh, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Should I quiet them for that? Absolutely not. And he lets him know, don't you know I'm getting praise anyway? Let me tell all of us something here. You could be quiet and I could be quiet. Jesus got a rock. Jesus got a rock. Jesus got a tree. Jesus got a whale, a dolphin, a shark, an octopus, a squid, a rhino, a behemoth. Listen, I don't know much about all animals, but I know the giraffe has got to be blessed. He must look down and say, I'm closer to heaven than all of you. I mean, that's all I can say for the land animals. Right, the eagle may laugh at the giraffe, but I'm even closer. But I know the giraffe is like, listen, I'm up here. I'm a little closer to God than you. Amen. Oh, yeah. See, that's why, David, I understand when you consider the moon and the work of his fingers. See, David considered it. You have to read the book of Psalms. There's a phrase in there that says, the works of the Lord are studied. Did you know that? The works of the Lord are studied by those who have pleasure in them. Oh, you want a reason to praise God? Study his works. Study his works. Study his works. Oh, glory to God. The Lord, the works of the Lord are studied by those who have pleasure in them. You say when you study the works of the Lord, you're going to praise him for the mighty works. Let me tell you, saints, we're going to give God glory. Amen. Hold on. Excuse me. Rocks, I'm going to join with you in giving God glory. Rock, Mount Everest, I know you hear me. Adirondacks, Catskills, Shenandoah, Rockies, Kilimanjaro, I know you hear. I know the Pacific. That's why the waves flop around like they do. Atlantic, Indian, Baltic, Mediterranean, giving God glory. Giving God glory. Amen. Consider the work of his fingers. I ain't got to watch no news. I got news right here. You know what news I got? I know this. I know this. CNN, NBC, I don't know why I keep saying CNN. Who's another one? Yeah, I don't know. Whoever it is. Fox. Okay, for whatever. Thank you. Let me tell you something. They're going to tell me about somebody dying. But you know what I know? People die. I just read about fear of death. But I know the resurrection and the life. See, they can only tell me about death. See, we have the answer, but I don't know. We keep telling people about houses and cars. The world knows that houses and cars don't make you happy. Look how many Hollywood people are wherever they are. All the money and not happy. Come on. So all I point out is death. I know about death. But a mighty work is resurrection. A mighty work is resurrection. Oh, amen. That's a mighty work. And that's a reason to praise God. Come on. Look at what it says here. So I want to say this. Close on this. And some of the Pharisees, these are religious people. You might have some religious people who question you. I want to encourage you in this. Here's a way to answer people. Here's a way. People say, you still gathering? You say, you know what, brother? Praise God. I want you to be blessed, but I know that I need to be with some saints. That's it. And you just say, I want you to be blessed. But, you know, because there's some churches gathering. I know there was one in Farmingdale, obviously the man in Florida. I'm sure there's others. Let me tell you, when you gather, you're going to get a different news. You're going to get a different news. Oh, yes. Let me tell you something. See, the Pharisees, these are religious people. They're telling the disciples to be quiet. Because this is what the world is saying. Listen, it's okay for you to talk about Jesus, but just not now. Don't you know we have a crisis? But when is it ever right to talk about Jesus? Before this happened, did they say we need to have prayer in schools? Did they say, oh, you know, let's start reading the Bible so people could act more morally, so we could empty our prisons? Did you hear that before this happened? Did anybody hear that? So understand, there's never on planet Earth, there's never a convenient or good time to talk about Jesus. Oh, amen. Nobody's putting up the Jesus sign now. Did you see any news media say we need Jesus? I didn't see it today, and I didn't see it before this came. I didn't even see it 9/11. Didn't see it in Watergate. I don't see it. Tornado Sandy. I didn't see nobody says we need Jesus. No matter the circumstances, the world is not going to tell you need Jesus. Religious people. Well, listen, come on now. People need real answers. Jesus is a real answer. I don't think people believe the Bible. Christians don't believe it. If it's at a house, a car, or a boat, they don't have faith. Oh, you got to praise him for his mighty works. His works are all over creation. If you are a spiritual person thinking naturally, you're going to be just like them. Just like them. Unhappy, wanting to know why, and here's the why. Here's the why for everything. No matter what goes on, you can always say this. God is going to get his glory. Amen. And if you are saved, you can rejoice that God is getting glory. It does not matter if John Davis's day goes the way John Davis wants it to go. I know I shock you, right? I know I shock you. Amen. That is so irrelevant. God in his mercy has given me numerous blessed days. Numerous blessed friends. I'm blessed with people who put up with me. They put up with me. That's a mighty work right there. Amen. That's a work of the grace right there. Putting up with me, you know that's the kingdom right there coming down. Glory. Amen. But let me tell you something. God gets glory. When my eye bleeds, God gets glory. Amen. When it doesn't bleed, he gets glory. Oh, I've learned. My wife, I don't complain. I just get frustrated, but I know it's Jesus. Amen. Getting glory. But today I'm preaching, nothing in the eye. Nothing in the eye today. Some days I'll be preaching, whoo, it's coming up. Because I'm talking hard. but you got to preach hard. And you know, it's amazing. I just a personal testimony. That's why I thank God for that. Because if it wasn't for his grace, somebody would say, well, maybe you shouldn't preach so hard. Somebody said that. I'm like, what do you mean to preach so hard? Because my eye fills up with blood? I know already that's a no-brainer. I know that's a no-brainer for me. Other people have to figure this out for themselves. They do. And I mean that. You have to. That's why that. See what it says? Of all the mighty works they had seen. If you have not seen God work in your life in a certain way, I don't expect you to buy into what I'm preaching. But when you know what he can do, amen. God gives you 54 years of great health and you're going to preach softly because an eye bleeds? As David said, may the Lord do so more to me. Amen. To shut your mouth after 54 years of living it up, whether you stupid, ignorant or not, talking about me, and then you get a health issue and you're going to hold back preaching? Oh, have mercy. Have mercy. And that's why I'm where I am. And I'll be here Sunday after Sunday. Because God is good. I know a mighty work. I know a mighty work. I got a mirror. Not that you could see it, but listen. Amen. God's got grace. Let me tell you something. Rejoice in him. Rejoice in him. And ask the Lord for blessings upon your life at this time. And pray, Lord, we want to gather and worship. You know, you hear people, even saints, oh, we got to get back to our jobs. Listen, I pray for people in financial straits. I do. You pray for them. We're fortunate. Some of us here have jobs. We're still getting paid. But some are not. So we pray for them. But let's pray. Come on. Let's pray for some glory for God, for some faith. Amen. Oh, man. Come on. Mighty works. Mighty works. You know, this is what I do know. Those songs, a lot of other songs, the bigger the trial, the bigger the testimony. People sing that all the time. But the minute the trial comes, they don't want the trial. But you can't have it. Listen, it's not in the Bible, but isn't it true? You can't have a testimony without a test. Amen. You can't have a testimony without a test. Everybody wants a testimony, but nobody wants a test. Amen. Come on now. Mighty works. When you see a mighty work, you could preach it. You could preach it. I mean, you could preach it. You could go to your neighbor and say how mighty God is and let him know. Oh, I'm not worried about this. Not because I don't care about humanity. I just know that the Jesus who died on the cross and rose from the dead 3 days later, who ascended into heaven, who is seated at the right hand of God the Father, he is much larger than all of this. Father God, bless this day. Bless our hearts to rejoice in your power, your might, and your grace. May you give us a word of hope for those who you've ordained to eternal life. You're a great God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.